Welcome to the broadcast. This evening we look at the military engagement that began over the weekend, and we begin with David Martin, CBS News Pentagon correspondent.
We're going to get all of the targets that can be gotten from the air. The question is, what will you have then? And I think what you'll have is basically the freedom to operate aircraft over Afghanistan, and then you can see what the rest of the strategy, which is going to be a ground-based strategy, can produce when you have control of the sky.
And we continue with Fouad Ajami and Jim Hoagland.
We are betting on the Northern Alliance. We are betting on the fact that we could crack this regime, because we understand that unless there is a change on the ground in Afghanistan, we can't go out and chase around Osama bin Laden in the hills of Afghanistan. So whatever our war aims say, we are drawn into the making of a regime in Afghanistan.
What they would like to see, probably in the best of all worlds, is us get him out of there, get rid of him day one, day two. They don't want it to drag on. If it drags on, they'll start peeling off and they'll have to make their deals with their own extremists. But right now, they would like it over fast. If we can't do that, then they're in trouble.
And because New York has been at the center of the attention of the tragedy of September 11th and the response and the recovery, we'll talk about the politics of this city. There is a runoff in the Democratic primary, and there's a general election coming up in November. The presence of Mayor Giuliani looms large. We'll hear from four journalists.
In other words, on September 25th, with the possibility of Giuliani looming as having a third term, I think maybe a lot of voters who were sympathetic to Giuliani might have sat that out, just waiting to see how that resolved itself. Now that it has resolved itself, there's a chance that some of those voters are going to be more serious about going to the polls.
In the past couple of days, some things have happened that might have turned the momentum the other way, for what it's worth. But there's a war going on. For example, Mario Cuomo today endorsed Mark Green and did it in a very, very strong way, which could have resonance with the type of voters that Ferrer's have trouble getting. Will people notice? A lot of people thought that Green scored a lot of points on Ferrer on two debates yesterday. Will people notice? I don't know.
He only got 6 to 7% of the white vote in the primary, and now in the runoff, I think that there are liberal Democrats who say, you know, we've had enough of a Republican mayor, and it's time for a change. And so they thought that they would be comfortable with Freddie Ferrer because he stood up to the mayor and said, come December 31st, this guy's out, and we're going to get a new mayor, and he's going to be a Democrat.
The war in Afghanistan and the politics in New York when we continue.
Funding for Charlie Rose is made possible by Amazon.com, your online source for everything from books, music, and toys to videos, electronics, and tools.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
The war on terrorism took on a new dimension on Sunday as the United States and Great Britain launched airstrikes in Afghanistan against the Taliban and against Osama bin Laden. The airstrikes continued today. Secretary Rumsfeld, the President, and Prime Minister Blair reacted to the bombing.
These are not strikes against Afghanistan. Even as we conduct these strikes, we are not only engaged in a massive humanitarian effort for the Afghan people, but we're reaching out to a range of Afghan groups on the ground in the north and in the south, as well as Afghan exiles and disaffected elements within the Taliban who are opposed to Taliban's policy of turning their nation into a haven for foreign terrorists.
As to the precise British involvement, I can confirm that last Wednesday, the United States government made a specific request that a number of UK military assets be used in the operation which has now begun, and I gave authority for these assets to be deployed. The world understands that whilst, of course, there are dangers in acting, the dangers of inaction are far, far greater. The threat of further such outrages, the threat to our economies, the threat to the stability of the world.
The best defense against terror is a global offensive against terror, wherever it might be found. Yesterday, we opened another front on the war on terrorism as we began conventional military operations designed to destroy terrorist training camps and military installations of the Taliban government.
There were some demonstrations against the attacks in the streets of Pakistan. Back in Washington, Tom Ridge was confirmed as Director of Homeland Security. We'll talk about the attacks this evening and also talk about the reaction in the Arab world. We begin with David Martin. He is the Pentagon correspondent for CBS News. David, what did they learn from the first attack?
Well, they don't have a handle yet on how much damage they did. I think it's a function of satellite passes and how long it takes the analysts to work over the photographs. So I think that's one reason today was a very limited strike. I mean, it was about a third the size of the first day's strikes because they really don't have a good handle yet on what they accomplished on the first day. But at his press conference today, Defense Secretary Rumsfeld was not ready to declare that they had taken down the Taliban air defense network, such as it is, or that they had eliminated all of the Taliban's command and control facilities. So they still really don't know where they're at. But look, we're talking about the United States of America versus the Taliban. I'm sure, spend more in the first few hours of any one day than they spend on defense in an entire year. So there's no doubt here that we're going to get all of the targets that can be gotten from the air. The question is, what will you have then? And I think what you'll have is basically the freedom to operate aircraft over Afghanistan, and then you can see what the rest of the strategy, which is going to be a ground-based strategy, can produce when you have control of the sky.
Are they worried about civilian casualties?
Yes, they're always worried about civilian casualties as a matter of principle, but here, since one of the great arguments is whether or not this is a war against Islam as opposed to a war against Osama bin Laden, they are taking extraordinary pains not to cause civilian casualties. And of course, they are also doing these airdrops of food. Again, I think on the principle that you have starving people down there, but also it reinforces the fact that this is not against the Islamic religion, not against Muslim people. It's against the Taliban and Osama bin Laden. And by the way, if that food happens to win over any people, then you've recruited potential intelligence sources on the whereabouts of Osama bin Laden, which of course is the big prize in this game.
Why did Rumsfeld call it the so-called war?
So-called war, because it's not going to look, as he has said many times, like any other war. This is not going to look like the Persian Gulf War. It's not going to look like the war against Serbia. It's going to look, to my mind, it's going to look more like the war against drugs, which is not necessarily a very encouraging analogy, because look how much progress we've made in the war against drugs. You know, there's a earlier in the 90s, the Delta Force, the crack American commandos, went down to Colombia, worked side by side with the Colombian police in helping them track down Pablo Escobar, who was then public enemy number one, the world's most infamous drug lord. And they had to do some pretty dicey stuff. They were working side by side with some Colombian assassination squads, and although the Colombians were doing the shooting, the U.S. was in essence countenancing these sort of tactics. Well, they finally got Pablo Escobar, but you know, the amount of drugs coming into this country from Colombia has actually gone up since. So even if we get Osama bin Laden, have we really achieved victory? And I think what Secretary Rumsfeld and a lot of other officials are trying to do is prepare people for the fact that it's not that simple.
What's the scenario for not getting Osama bin Laden?
Well, I think at the very least, you keep him on the defensive. right now, it would be hard for me to imagine that he is able to sit there and direct and plan anything remotely like the September 11th attacks. He is hunkered down, and he hasn't yet been smoked out, which of course is what President Bush is saying that the U.S. is going to do. But he definitely is hunkered down, and I think he's on the defensive. The U.S. carpet bombed some of his training camps yesterday. That doesn't prevent him from going back in there and rebuilding and restarting operations at some later date. But right now, I think he's been denied use of those camps.
How close do they think they can pinpoint where he is?
Well, certainly not close enough to hit him from the air. I think they have a good idea of where he hangs out, but you know, it's like saying you have a good idea of what city a particular criminal you're looking for in the United States is in. That doesn't tell you exactly how to get him. I think their only way they're going to get a location that is good enough to either capture or kill him with is to be on the ground and collecting the kind of intelligence you can only collect on the ground from the local citizens who know who these so-called Arabs are and where they live. That's how they refer to Osama bin Laden and his lieutenants as the Arabs. They know where they are. They know which camps are active and which aren't. And of course, you then have all these guerrilla groups and these tribal leaders who now see the chance to get out from under the Taliban. And they're going to cooperate, or at least that's the theory, that they're going to cooperate with the U.S., tell the U.S. what they know about where bin Laden might be. And all of this might come together and produce the piece of intelligence that you need in order to nab him.
If they are doing this kind of bombing that they did yesterday, they being the United States and Great Britain, principally the United States, if they're doing what they did yesterday and today and perhaps the rest of this week, does that mean that ground forces have to be coming pretty quickly behind the bombing?
I think it depends what you mean by ground forces, Charlie.
I mean special forces and
people.
You mean
like U.S. commando units.
Right.
You mean the Delta Force going
exactly.
in and nabbing.
Right.
No, I don't think that necessarily has to follow immediately on the heels of airstrikes, because the ground army that's already there, the Northern Alliance, the rebel army that's in the north, they, I think, are going to be the foot soldiers for this operation. And they're going to, what Secretary Rumsfeld said very clearly is that they are trying to alter the balance of power. And we're already giving this rebel army intelligence on the disposition of Taliban troops. And as soon as we succeed in keeping their air force from flying at all, then we will, in effect, have given the rebel army air cover. And sooner or later, they're going to be able to start advancing. There has not been any major advances yet, but we are only in day two of this.
But I think sooner or later means within a week or so, does it or not?
The U.S. over the years has placed so many false hopes in these rebel armies. You
right.
can go all the way back to Cuba. So I think putting a tough timetable or a short timetable on the progress of a rebel army is very dicey stuff.
But then tell me how, as far as you can tell by what they say, either publicly or privately, how confident are they that the United Forces, the so-called Northern Alliance, can do it, will do it?
But it's not just those forces. You have all these tribes in the south, which I think, in fact, the U.S. would rather see succeed than the Northern Alliance, because the Northern Alliance is anathema to Pakistan, whereas the tribes in the south are of the same ethnic makeup as many of the citizens of Pakistan. The enemy of my enemy is my friend. That's the theory here, and anybody that is willing to take up arms or to commit sabotage or do anything to make life difficult for the Taliban or for Osama bin Laden is going to get assistance from the U.S.
Thank you very much, David.
Sure thing.
David Martin, CBS News Pentagon correspondent. Back in a moment. Stay with us. Joining me now in Washington is Jim Hoagland of The Washington Post and Fouad Ajami of Johns Hopkins University and U.S. News and World Report. I am pleased to have both of them here as we consider the events of the last 24 hours. Jim, the military airstrikes, what can we say about them? What impact are they having? Is any reason to believe that any different than the military, than sort of the conventional wisdom, which is that they are essentially to remove some kind of firepower from the Taliban so that A, they can drop food supplies to the refugees, and B, whatever else comes after this will meet with less resistance and air cover?
Yes, I think we can take that at face value. Today's operation sounded like a little more of a mopping up or a follow through on yesterday's raids. I suspect we will see continuous raids now over the next week or two. We've got a couple of deadlines staring us in the face in terms of military action in Afghanistan. One is weather closing in, winter beginning certainly by the beginning of November, but also around November 10th we will see the start of the holy month of Ramadan, a month of fasting by Muslims around the world. Does the United States want to continue military operations during Ramadan? That's going to be a very tough question to answer. So I think there's a feeling, let's get as much done as we can now. Let's clear the way, perhaps, for the Northern Alliance to begin some kind of big offensive on the ground the next 4 or 5 days, and let's see what happens.
Mm. And as David Martin said earlier in this program, they're also expecting a lot from the South, too, from some of the groups in the South to provide, because they bring less protests from the Pakistanis.
That's right. I think that's one of the big questions we need to begin to focus on now. It's the real big void in the administration's strategy, certainly in their articulated strategy. What comes next in Afghanistan? They've been very reluctant to be drawn out on that. They say they're not engaged. That is, the Bush administration says they're not engaged in nation building. They're not trying to, they don't have the overthrow of the Taliban or regime change as their stated goal. They dance around that question a lot, but we need to begin to focus on it. And having action in the South, spreading the base of the war, really, and certainly of any future government, is very important.
Okay. Let me come to the second thing. Go ahead. You want to speak to this? But
no,
you
have I think Jim has outlined it well. Look, we own the sky and the sea lanes of that world, and Osama bin Laden owns the streets. That's pretty much the outline as it is now.
The streets in Islamabad or the streets throughout the Arab world?
I think the streets throughout the Arab and Muslim world. Let's be candid about this, and we should talk about this today. And I think, as apropos of what Jim said, even though we don't say that overthrowing the Taliban regime is a stated war aim, we have to be candid. It's an unstated aim of this war. We are betting on the Northern Alliance. We are betting on the fact that we could crack this regime, because we understand that unless there is a change on the ground in Afghanistan, we can't go out and chase around Osama bin Laden in the hills of Afghanistan. So whatever our war aims say, we are drawn into the making of a regime in Afghanistan.
So the first step to getting Osama bin Laden and the terrorist organization that he stands on top of is to get the Taliban out of the way.
Well, it's our hope that we will get lucky, that this regime will crack, that it's not really what it's made out to be, that it's much more fragile than we think, and that maybe people, the Northern Alliance or the upheaval within or the hungry people within, will overthrow these radical seminarians, the Taliban. And even though we might not claim this, because we don't want to fall short of this, we have memories of the Gulf War, what the regime change is or isn't a stated war aim. And in this case, I think, even though it's not stated, it is what we aim to do.
Correct, Jim?
Yes, I think Fouad's exactly right. We have no choice, really. Osama bin Laden, the Taliban, certainly the Mullah Omar faction of the Taliban, they're the same thing. There are marriage links between them. If you don't get the Taliban, you don't get Osama bin Laden. I think it's very clear.
Osama bin Laden spoke over the weekend.
Right.
Tell me what that meant, because I heard you translate it over on CBS.
Well, this is Osama bin Laden, if you will. I mean, it is the cult figure Osama bin Laden, and this was his message to the Muslim world. Some of it was the familiar diatribe against America. Some of it was staking out of this new, you know, this large territory for Osama bin Laden, the American presence in Arabia, the matter of Palestine, the matter of Iraq, and the suffering of the Iraqi people. And it's really, in many ways, it was also an attempt to scare the rulers of the Muslim world, because he divided the world into the party of the faithful and the party of the wicked, and he took on a whole bunch of issues, including what America did against Japan in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So it's kind of the voice of the oppressed the world over. And
children of Iraq and all
right.
that.
And then he ranged over what happened to the Arab world over the last 80 years. I couldn't really get the meaning of 80 years, except that 80 years is it goes back to 1920, 21, and the creation of the modern Middle East. So it was all the sins of America. Everything was done, and the chilling reminder that we will not have peace. I mean, and I think, unfortunately, we have to take him at his word.
As a rhetorical device,
yes,
speaking to the streets,
yes,
and to the rulers,
yes,
in the Arab world,
right,
was it effective, you think?
Well, look, no translation. I mean, that's the whole pain of translation and the difficulty of translation. No translation can tell us how this man sounds to his own followers and to these undecided people who are listening to him. We do know that now there are people who tell us that there are all kinds of favorable responses to him, all the way from Arabia, from Saudi Arabia itself, where the reporters have come back with all kinds of interesting verdicts, that people think Osama bin Laden is the true voice of the Arab and the true voice of Islam, to Gaza, where there are very, very enlightened Palestinian analysts who concede that the street belongs to Osama bin Laden. And then, of course, to that kind of disgruntled middle class, if you will, throughout the Arab world and the Islamic world, which is not really buying in and joining our side.
How consequential is that, the fact that the streets belong to him, and that this may well have created a resonance among lots of people, this
thing
on Al Jazeera television?
You know, we have a military war with Osama bin Laden, and that we will just prosecute the way we prosecute all war. And then we have an ideological battle.
But how do we fight that battle?
We can't fight it very well. The Muslims have to fight it for themselves. The Arabs have to fight it for themselves. In effect, what we've tried to do is we've tried to say, look, there is no middle ground between civilization on the one hand and terror on the other. But the fact of the matter is that these middle classes in the Arab Muslim world are winking at Osama bin Laden, and they do see him as a kind of avenger, a man who will humble the United States. And one of the problems with going to Afghanistan is, if you will, is we are going to the tail of the trail rather than the head of the trail. Jim Hoagland, I don't want to steal his theme, but he had a column a couple of weeks ago, which was a remarkable column called Out of the Gulf, that in effect, and I had a little column which I submitted to the New York Times magazine as Out of Egypt.
Yeah.
So we do have a tributary from the Gulf and a tributary from Egypt. So when we go and chase after Osama bin Laden in Afghanistan, we go to the pad that he rented from the Taliban. But the problem we have in the Gulf and in Egypt, these two tributaries, if you will, that's where our troubles are most tenacious.
Egypt and Saudi Arabia.
Well, Egypt and the entire world of the Gulf.
Yeah.
And that's really, I mean, that was Jim's...
All those Gulf states from...
We talked, like, for
Saudi
example...
Saudi Arabia, Kuwait.
Well, take, for example, this Jazeera television. This is the problem...
Al Jazeera television,
yes,
right.
This is the television station that Osama bin Laden uses as his mail drop, if you will.
Yeah.
And, you know, the nature of the world is what it is. Osama bin Laden is a big star. He's on the cover of Time magazine. He sends a tape. We all have to rush and listen to what he has to say. But Al Jazeera television is owned by the Emir of Qatar. The Prince of Qatar is the de facto owner of Al Jazeera television. So he could hide behind freedom of the press and all the lot, but nevertheless, we have a television station, a channel, which engages in a healthy amount of anti-Americanism and anti-Zionism and all the lot, but the man who owns it is our ally in the Gulf. And we don't know how to read...
Come to you in 1 second, Jim. I know you're ready to jump in. I want to hear what you pick up on it, but let me just ask this one thing. Then you are saying that in order to engage for the hearts and minds of the street.
Sure.
Who has to speak up and carry the voice against Osama bin Laden and whatever he is saying?
People have to be willing to even walk with us in broad daylight. Our president says 40 countries have signed in on our coalition, wall-to-wall coalition against terrorism. But he has not given permission to even name any of the Arab countries, because they are very, very hesitant and very skittish about us arriving there. And they are lucky, because for the most part, in the initial strike against Afghanistan, if that's where we go first, which we have gone first, this is our first strike in Afghanistan, it's far away from them. But at some point, if we have to engage these broader questions that, again, I think Jim is interested in and wants to talk about, we have to go back and take a step back and deal with our Arab assets and our position in the Arab world.
Pick up on that, Jim.
Well, I think one of the most significant developments here in day two of airstrikes against Afghanistan is that there is not a single fully enthusiastic statement of support from any Arab government. Jordan has put out a statement that does go in the direction of support for this kind of operation, although not for these specific operations. And that says a lot. I think it makes the point that Fouad is making very, very well. The silence is eloquent. The silence from Egypt, from Saudi Arabia. The Al Jazeera television is not allowed to vent criticism of the government of Qatar. It operates, as does much of the Arab media, as a safety valve, as a shield to deflect criticism from the governments and on to the United States. To answer your question, I think it is very important that the Arab governments cease showing fear of the street, which is what they're doing by maintaining silence here. It's very important that the Islamic authorities in these countries speak out very clearly and show their support for justice in the world and their opposition, their condemnation of these kinds of operations undertaken by Osama bin Laden.
In the name of religion.
That's right. We are saying he does not represent Islam. It would be nice if the chief religious authorities in Egypt would say the same thing.
Do you expect them to change?
I think they have to. I think what we're looking at here is the threat of a change of political systems throughout the Arab world if these kind of pressures are not dealt with and dealt with soon. I think it's important to not say that Osama bin Laden owns the Arab street. I don't think he does. I think Fouad put it well. Osama bin Laden is seen as an avenger. He's a vehicle for the resentments that are building up, have been building up for decades, if not centuries, about the failure of Arab governments, the failure of Arab society to meet minimal standards of jobs, of democracy, of social decency. They haven't done it. They need to begin to deal with the problems that create these resentments that get focused on the United States. I think the resentments are focused really on policy, on the policy of the United States, and not really on America itself. But there is resonance there, but I don't think the people in the Arab street want to follow the kind of strict, almost fanatical Wahhabi Islam, the strict code of Wahhabism within Islam that Osama bin Laden represents.
Look, Osama bin Laden has no, I mean, Jim is absolutely right. He has no vision of what the Arab future would be about. I mean, it would be a reign of virtue and terror. It would be a reign akin to what the Taliban have unleashed on the poor people of Afghanistan. He's a bandit, he's a killer, he's a murderer. But these frustrated middle classes, they have no way of standing up to their rulers. They have not been able to change the rulers. There's a kind of this malignant anti-Americanism as a substitute for practical politics, and we are caught in the middle between rulers who refuse to walk with us and an oppositional forces that hold us responsible for the rulers. I mean, I'll take you, for example, to there is something that has interested me recently. It is this deputy of Osama bin Laden, and he tells a very interesting story, a very intriguing story.
Who led a terrorist organization that merged with him to give...
Right. That's Dr. Ayman Zawahiri.
Right.
He's an MD, he's 50 years old, and more there's evidence that's coming that says that in many ways he may be the brains of the outfit.
And he was there alongside Laden when he made his
He was
video.
There alongside bin Laden. He comes, this man is an intriguing man. I've been interested in him and fate has delivered into my hands. I've had this document.
Fate?
Well, you know, I've had this document for about 20 years, and all of a sudden it acquired new poignancy, which is the interrogation of Ayman Zawahiri that the police had with him after the assassination of Anwar Sadat. Almost now, we are literally 20 years to the day after the assassination of Anwar Sadat. And Ayman Zawahiri was part of 300 people who were rounded up. This is the so-called Egyptian Islamic Jihad. He was then a 30-year-old medical doctor, very active in the Islamic cause, a son of one of the most distinguished families in Egypt. By comparison with him, Hosni Mubarak is just a son of a middle-class peasant background of modest origins. And so Ayman Zawahiri now swears he will only go back to Egypt as a conqueror. These are his words. He wants to go back to Egypt as a conqueror. And make no mistake about it, the account between Hosni Mubarak's regime and Ayman Zawahiri is a very personal account. This man was arrested, he was tortured, he bears the regime a grudge, he holds us responsible for all the ills of the Mubarak regime. And there we stand, we are caught in the middle, in a battle between the ruling powers in the saddle and the pious, fanatical Islamic opposition from below. And no one is willing to claim us as friends. No one is willing to speak for us. I can assure you there have been no publications in the Arab world, and I track that very, very closely, and I've tracked this very closely for you as well, which is no publications, no one speaks well of us. No one speaks well of this distant power. I mean, we won, for example, a war in Bosnia on behalf of the Muslims and a war in Kosovo on behalf of the Muslims, but we got no credit. No credit.
Why is that?
I have no idea.
Well,
Jim?
Yeah, I think it's
hard. It is true. I mean, about Kosovo and Bosnia.
Absolutely.
And supporting the Mujahideen in Afghanistan against the Russians. We had our own reasons, but there you go.
Well, there's the reflex of not wanting to know something that shakes your fundamental belief.
Or your fundamental point of view.
Your point of view. I think there's also something that comes into play here that's important. The feeling of victimization in the Arab world and to some extent in the broader Muslim world. Because of the historic decline within the Middle East of Arab power. They see themselves as victims. It's not possible to get outside of that framework and see that somebody is helping them in a beneficial way. They have to explain their current plight, their current victimization, by the great power outside pushing them down. I think it's simply a case of not being able to see something that challenges their basic point of view.
Okay, but do I hear you saying, both of you saying, and I think I do, and I think it's obvious to the audience, but do both of you saying that in fact, some of these silent partners in the coalition who we have not heard from, whether it's Saudi Arabia or whether it's Egypt or where it might be, measures of silence differ, that they want us to defeat the terrorists and bin Laden and the Taliban. They just don't want to be involved in it. You're shaking your head. That's not it at all.
I don't think they are frightened of Osama bin Laden and of the Taliban. I think this is a fundamental point that we have to understand about this crisis of 2001 as opposed to the crisis of 1991. That's okay. Bush 1. In 1991, they were menaced. In 2001, we are menaced. These regimes, Algeria, Tunisia, Egypt, and Saudi Arabia, to a lesser extent because they didn't have that tenacious and Islamist challenge. They beat the Islamist movement, and these bandits, these Islamists, these radical terrorists, they took to the road and nested in Hamburg and Berlin and Leiden and Jersey City and Brooklyn. And these regimes can look at this phenomenon with sly indifference, with sly indifference. And in a way, look at the irony, if you really want the brutal irony of this. These countries in the Middle East, instead of making their country like ours, what happened on September 11, 2001, if you will, just for symmetry's sake, they made our country like theirs. So there is soot and ruin in our streets, as they believe there is soot and ruin in their streets. And they don't have any sense of sympathy for us. We should not kid ourselves about this.
None of the states you mentioned have any sense of sympathy
I think in this fight, we are, as Jim said, we are dealing with an Anglo-American alliance.
But in some ways, this is really the point, Charlie. This is the crucial point to understand, that the kind of actions we're taking now in Afghanistan force these regimes into the you're with us or against it. Both Bush and Osama bin Laden have said the same thing.
Yeah, exactly. That was the interesting thing that said.
And the continuation of these kinds of operations does put these regimes on the spot. What they would like to see, probably in the best of all worlds, is us get him out of there, get rid of him day one, day two. They don't want it to drag on. If it drags on, they'll start peeling off and they'll have to make their deals with their own extremists. Right now, they would like it over fast. If we can't do that, then they're in trouble.
There's another point that I know both Jim and I are interested in, which is, of course, after, you know, it's like after Afghanistan. Like, do we step back? Because we know there was a battle royale in the Bush administration between people who would like to do Afghanistan plus Saddam.
Right.
Plus Iraq, that if indeed the trail in any way establishes any Iraqi culpability, we may have to return to the source of the trouble. We may have to return to the unfinished war, to the unfinished verdict of that
91.
War. Exactly, of 1991, the sins of the father being visited on the son, that because we didn't finish off Saddam Hussein, we had to leave a force in Arabia, because we left a force in Arabia to monitor the no-fly zone in southern Iraq. We end up radicalizing the place in many ways and giving Osama bin Laden his
rhetorical flourish
exactly,
about children.
Exactly. So we have this. If we now step back and we say, well, maybe we should take up Iraq next, then what will happen in the Arab world? Then really it will be the time for them to consider the choice that they have to face. But thus far,
and that's not an easy bet.
It's not. We don't know what will happen. Afghanistan is far away from them. Afghanistan is different.
So you assume that the United States will be able to, at some point, Jim, and with respect for all the time limits that you suggested, at some point will be able to overcome the Taliban.
Well, I would think so.
And get Osama bin Laden.
That may take longer, in fact, if he runs.
Where is he going to run to? You mean as a refugee into
Baluchistan,
Pakistan?
In Pakistan, in areas where there is no government control in Pakistan. There are other badlands scenarios that you can draw
up. So you can see him escaping even if the Taliban fall?
Yes, I could see that happening. And then I think we still have the obligation to continue to track him forever.
You suggested that this war is one over morals as much as it is in military conflict. Quote, as bin Laden tries to spread mass fear, the United States and its allies must continue to show that their purpose to remove fear for Americans and for everyone else. The measured nature and scope of the initial attack strongly suggests that the Bush administration understands this fundamental point. This is an important and positive result of day one.
And I would hope of day two. We haven't gotten the full reports in, but apparently they're going to continue to drop rations, emergency rations, for the starving Afghan refugees. And they've emphasized America's concern, its outreach to the Muslim world. This is not a war against Islam. They've said the right things.
Yeah, and they need people in the Arab world to say the right things.
That's right, to say what I've just said, that's what we're about, that's what we're doing, that's the kind of country we are.
I mean, never in his wildest dreams, when he set out to be president, did George W. Bush think he has to run an Eastern Empire. But let's face it, we have to run an Eastern Imperium. We have now to worry about what will happen in Afghanistan. We have to become familiar. We have to get ourselves a crash course in the ethnicities and the complicated politics of both the Middle East and South Asia. And may God help us, because it's a world alien to us. I mean, I take you back just a few months ago. Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld wanted to terminate the peacekeeping force between Israel and Egypt and Sinai, because it cost $16 million on budgetary ground. And now we have tens of billions of dollars pledged to this twilight war between order on the one hand and this dark, very, very amorphous world of terror on the other. And it's the brutal irony of the presidency of George W. Bush.
On that note, thank you, Fouad Ajami, here in New York with me, and Jim Hoagland, again, from Washington. Thank you, Jim.
Thank you, Charlie.
Thank you. Bye,
Good
Jim.
Good night, Fouad.
We'll be right back. Stay with us. We'll turn our attention to a different subject this evening. Much talk because of the tragedy in New York about Mayor Giuliani. We'll talk a little bit about his successor. Stay with us. Joining me now are four New York journalists who have been covering the mayoral race. Adam Nagourney of the New York Times, Michael Kramer, managing editor of the New York Daily News, Michael Tomasky of New York Magazine, Marcia Kramer with WCBS Television here in New York. I am pleased to have each of them here. You have, on this Monday evening, poll results from the New York Daily News.
New numbers, the tyranny of numbers.
All right.
You will not be surprised to know
that
this race is still basically tied. This is a poll that we did in conjunction with the New York one, which will come out this evening. And it has Ferrer leading by 2 points among likely voters with 11% undecided.
That's a change.
It's a change from 45-45 to 46-44. It's a change. What it means is what it's meant for, I think, the past few days, which is that it's really incredibly tight. What I think is interesting in here is that the Black-Latino coalition that people like myself made light of apparently has come together in this sense. Green's share of the black vote has slipped to 30%, and Ferrer's has increased to 63% in this poll, and that seems to have been responsible for closing the gap. And one of the reasons for this increase, or better showing on Ferrer's part among blacks, seems to be not the Reverend Al Sharpton's endorsement that was already accommodated before the primary, but the stance he took opposing Rudy Giuliani's term extension. And it seems that with those particular voters, it's made a big difference.
You got a big bump then. It's primarily with African-American voters
who
responded to the fact that he said, I'm not making any deal with the mayor.
That's right.
You agree with that? I saw you nodding your head in affirmation.
Yeah, I think that he did get a big bump from it. But the question is, did he also get a big bump from other Democrats, white Democrats, you know, in the runoff, in the primary? He only had
liberal Democrats?
He only got 6 to 7% of the white vote in the primary. And now in the runoff, I think that there are liberal Democrats who say, you know, we've had enough of a Republican mayor, and it's time for a change. And so they thought that they would be comfortable with Freddie Ferrer because he stood up to the mayor and said, come December 31st, this guy's out, and we're going to get a new mayor, and he's going to be a Democrat.
Does what he just said mean that there's some degree of momentum here for
Freddie Ferrer? I think there's been momentum for Freddie Ferrer since the night of the 25th, the primary, when he came in first, and most people didn't think he could come in first, and he scored very well. And normally in a campaign, you sort of have backs and forths, and a number of things have been helping him. And I think over the past couple of days, some things have happened that might have turned the momentum the other way, for what it's worth. But there's a war going on. For example, Mario Cuomo today endorsed Mark Green and did it in a very, very strong way, which could have resonance with the type of voters that Ferrer's had trouble getting. Will people notice? A lot of people thought that Green scored a lot of points on Ferrer on two debates yesterday. Will people notice? I don't know.
Michael, what do you think?
Mark Green's biggest challenge, I think, is to get white liberal voters back in his corner who may have been put off by his agreeing to the mayor's offer of a 3-month extension of his term. This may seem strange to your viewers around the country because Giuliani was just asking for 3 extra months to smooth the transition. He's got a 90% approval rating. He's been seen on TV as taking command and taking charge during this crisis. But the fact of the matter is, among a New York City Democratic primary electorate, as much as they appreciate the job he did after September 11th, he's still not a popular guy, and many of them don't want to see him be in office a day longer. Just to finish the thought, so when Mark Green said, yes, I would agree to an extra 3 months, he did lose some support in his natural base, progressive, liberal, white voters, and he has to get them back by Thursday.
He also has to make some inroads into less progressive white Democrats. The other interesting subset in this poll is that among white Catholic voters, that's everybody except basically Latinos and some Protestants, Green is leading, but there's 19% undecided. These are people who voted for Alan Hevesy and Peter Vallone mostly in the primary, and they seem to be up for grabs at this point. And it's these kinds of voters, many Italians, who could be affected positively for Green because of Mario Cuomo's endorsement of him today.
I mean, probably the big question is whether those people will vote at all or whether they'll vote for Mark Green, except for one thing. The Ferrer people have an ad up, which I think is a really effective ad, which shows Ferrer getting endorsed by Ed Koch, by Peter Vallone, by Geraldine Ferraro, by Moynihan,
Pat Moynihan.
And I think that really plays to people like that. If it doesn't bring out voters for Ferrer, it'll depress the white turnout for Mark Green that Mark Green needs to win this race. And I think that's the dynamic that's going on right
now. But the Green people have already said that they're going to use Cuomo in a commercial as quickly as they can get it up.
Oh, yeah, they sure
and I think that there's another thing that's going on here, and that you have to take a look at how solid these voters are. Freddie Ferrer's voters, if you ask them, how likely are you to vote for him, they're very solid. Mark Green's voters are not as solid and are more likely to change their mind between now and Election Day than the people who support Freddie Ferrer. So that's another big factor here, whether Mark Green can not only keep the voters who are voting for him, but convince the leaners that they should come back into the vote.
And come out, I should point out, on a Thursday. This is because of the calendar. The runoff's on a Thursday. Yeah. So only the most committed voters are going to turn out. You're right. That's what Ferrer voters right
We've
now.
Seen this dynamic before. We saw it with Dinkins when he won in 1989, when African-American voters felt very proud that one of their own had a chance to be mayor and came out in numbers that they hadn't
So this is what you expect from Latino voters.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, you can also see that because today Mark Green was going around to people saying, remember, the primary is not Tuesday, it's Thursday.
Exactly.
Yeah.
The notion of Giuliani, I saw this interesting story maybe in the Times, in which it was sort of like they were drawing this comparison to Churchill, you know, that we now that you won the war, would like to somebody else to get on with the recovery. Is that a factor? Is that what's at work among Democrats? A thankfulness that you have done what you have done, but
yes, a lot. Yes,
let's turn out.
Sure, combined with
something else.
It's just politics. We want one of our own as mayor.
The Democratic vote in this town is 5-1. 5 Democrats for every 1 Republican. They want a Democrat. And they think that Rudy Giuliani overreached by you know, spreading the stories that he was available to serve either in overturning term limits or in serving an extra 3 months. And, you know, quite frankly, politically, it was dead on arrival.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
the Democratic head of the state assembly was an enemy of Giuliani's, was never going to make it happen.
You know, it's really, the whole thing has been incredibly inexplicable to me.
Yeah.
It seemed...
Which part? That he did
it? After watching Giuliani for 10 years, what's inexplicable?
It was only 90 days. That's what was so inexplicable.
Think about this. Here you have a situation where a man wants to serve an extra period of time. It's only 3 months. But the people who are, you know, running, the candidates, mm-hmm. got no attention at all because everything was, Giuliani wants to run for mayor, maybe he wants to overturn term limits, maybe it's only 3 months. But what about the 4 people who are running in the primary?
Right.
They got zip attention, and the whole story, when it should have been focused on, like, what do each of these 4 people stand for, they
factor.
Got nothing. And instead, everybody was, Giuliani, is he going to serve?
Right.
Is he not going to serve?
This is another factor that could possibly help Mark Green. It depends, on, again, on who turns out and so forth. But now that Giuliani talk is moot, and the possibility of an extra term is buried, and the possibility even of a 3-month extension is buried, there may be a time now, there may be a sense now among white voters whom Green needs to reach that, okay, it's time to choose now, and you have to choose between these guys who are standing. In other words, on September 25th, with the possibility of Giuliani looming as having a third term, I think maybe a lot of voters who were sympathetic to Giuliani might have sat that out, just waiting to see how that resolved itself. Now that it has resolved itself, there's a chance that some of those voters are going to be more serious about going to the polls.
I think there's also a sense now that Green has been trying to push, which I think is true, that this is a very, very serious election, arguably the most important election in the city for 50 years, and I don't think people are going to be as willing to sit it out as they might have been.
This is simply because of the challenge.
Just the challenge.
No, but also there's the X factor. The X factor is what effect did going to war on Sunday have on people's psyches in terms of who they're going to vote for? Are they going to take a chance on someone who has had not had citywide experience? That would be Freddie Ferrer. Or are they going to, you know, say, okay, fine, it doesn't matter? I mean, that's the X factor that we don't.
But are we picking up on any of this kind of consideration in terms of?
The poll didn't get into it.
But I can tell you that on the street today, I got a sense of that. You know, I was at the Columbus Day Parade talking to people.
What did you get? What sense?
Well, the sense was that now that we're at war. You know, it's not only that we've been attacked, but now they're at war. We have to really think about it. And we also have to think about the plans that each of them have for rebuilding the city. And they have vastly different plans for redeveloping.
Ferrer doesn't have much of one.
And he would do it. He would take the financial center and he would disperse it in the outer boroughs.
Okay, there are two things that you just read the papers and the New Yorkers are doing. And I think this is important to a national audience because they're in love with Rudy Giuliani from a distance, and therefore the notion that, you know, that his term is coming to an end, and all the talk you've heard about him playing one role or the other, certainly in terms of an extension or in terms of some means of running again, is moot, is over, it's finished. So therefore, consideration of who the Democratic candidate. Am I wrong about that?
Right. No, you're absolutely right, 100% right.
Today, so far.
Yeah, right. You're right. So having said that, one of the things that I look at, just simply reading and not having talked to either of the two candidates in the runoff, is the following, that Green has been hammering at the notion of the connection to September 11th. Mm-hmm. And Farrar has been making passing reference to it, but hammering at the fact that,
Green has built his whole campaign on it. Ferrer is saying, yes, this is important, but the issues that I ran on as well, it's dramatically
that's
different.
That's my point. There's a very different view in terms of the significance of September 11th in their public approach to this.
But the kinds of things that Marcia and Adam are describing basically have to occur at this point in voters' heads, unmediated by what the candidates are doing. One of the things that the war is also doing is crowding out all coverage of these campaigns. Yeah. You have to read very far into the newspapers.
It's crowding out all the ads. I mean, remember, all their campaign ads.
It's wall-to-wall direct coverage.
Right, so their campaign ads. Yeah. I mean, you know, like we just said that, you know, they want
to
have a Mario Cuomo, that Mark Green wants to have a Mario Cuomo ad. Okay, fine, where?
Yeah.
You know, and at what time?
You got to buy the time, and there's not a lot of time to sell, or they won't get on the air if they're doing all the coverage.
So this will have to be kind of spontaneous, and exactly the questions of turnout that we're very interested in the primary come up, and it seems to me, I don't know what everybody else feels, that Ferrer's union endorsements matter more because those people seem to be better able to get that vote to the polls.
They're taking the day off, right?
I don't know whether they're not having what happened in Detroit.
Where they gave one primary day. All the union workers were off, and so therefore they could go
vote. These are mostly municipal employees, and they're not
going to get off. What about 1199? They don't get off, huh?
No, they're hospitalized.
But the fact that you have those three unions in a race like this on a low turnout day on a Thursday is huge. It's a big advantage for Ferrer.
They can call their members and say, have you voted yet? Please get to the polls. And they can send somebody to pick them up and take them if they need it.
Just a lot of assumptions have been turned upside down in this race, partly because of what happened on September 11th and partly for other reasons.
The city's changing.
Yeah, because the city's changing. I don't think anybody expected the Latino turnout to be a higher percentage of the Democratic electorate than the Jewish turnout, but it was on September 25th.
Including Ferrer's own people.
Yeah, they said likely to be in the playoff, in the runoff as well. Yeah. Higher percentage of Latino than Jewish.
Well, that's a really interesting question. We don't know any of
the
these things.
The reason
it's
an extra factor is that, you know,
question.
Asking people to vote twice is a difficult thing. It's hard enough to get your voters to the poll once.
That's right, three times, Marcia, right?
Well, right. Some of them actually voted on the 11th of September. So the question is, do the people who turned out actually turn out again? And that's another question that none of us knows the answer to.
What happens to Rudy Giuliani after he hands over the reins of this great city to whoever the new mayor is? What's he gonna do?
Well, he's a huge presence in the city automatically. He probably gets a newspaper column somewhere. He probably has a radio show. I doubt that he will observe, you know how presidents observe the one-year moratorium. He'll observe the one-day moratorium on criticizing his
four-year
successor.
I think for mayor
in 2005.
Or governor, I mean, you know.
Well, but does he want to be governor, or does he want to be mayor, or does he want to be president, or does he want to be...
He loves the job mayor.
Yeah, no question, I think.
So he would do all these things.
Yeah.
Now, will he be involved
in... The first thing he'll do is fight to repeal term limits. So this doesn't happen
again. So he can serve for three terms for next time.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Or four or five.
He's got 4 years to overturn that one.
What role do you think the mayor will play in terms of an official way in the recovery effort? Is there any position that looks like it's looming over there?
He's going to play the position of public scold, that whatever is not done that he doesn't like,
and in
he
New
will
York, that's an official position.
I mean, remember when Ed Koch left office, he was an official scold for 4 years. I think that he'll be the official scold. I think that a Democrat most likely would not be likely to give him a
position. Ferrer says he'd give him a job as the head of the cleanup.
No, it wasn't that, Adam. I think he had some.
It wasn't reconstruction. It was reclamation.
It was reclamation.
It was downgrade. It's true.
So I think Giuliani's going to want to be like, you know, the cleanup, the reclamation guy.
He's going to make money. He's going to have a bully pulpit of some kind.
He's got a book, too.
He's got a book. He'll get a TV.
Much bigger market.
Some TV thing, some radio thing, some column thing. And he'll make some the money, and he'll be in the public eye.
Landscape.
Everything that goes wrong, he'll be available to say, I would have done it this way, and, you know.
And it's a one thing that the city's not going to be as good 4 years from now as it is now. Yeah.
I mean, look at the economy. I mean, you know, you've got a lot of hard decisions. There's going to be layoff of workers or at least attrition. I mean, you've got a lot of tough problems.
The one thing that I think he could do, and that a Democrat or the next mayor should ask him to do, he has a unique authority to go around to corporations and businesses when this new office space is built and say, let me put you down for two floors here in this building. You know, come back to New York. You know, let me get you down for some office space here. He could do that. And the next mayor should be. Who would have more authority to do that?
I think it's great.
This is a great position, and that's what he should do.
On that note, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank all of you. We'll see what happens on Thursday in New York. A runoff Democratic primary takes place here, and we will know. Then the election will take place in November, and we will continue to watch this city recover. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Funding for Charlie Rose is made possible by Amazon.com, your online source for everything from books, music, and toys to videos, electronics, and tools.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
On the next Charlie Rose, we continue our coverage of the war against terrorism. We'll also hear from Queen Noor. As you know, she was married to King Hussein of Jordan. Join us.